Welcome to the Colonial Ministerium's online Good Friday worship service for 2021. We are glad that you are joining us today. We do miss the fellowship of being together in person, of gathering and seeing our friends and neighbors in the pews, shaking hands and greeting one another. But we're glad that you are here today. And you, your friends and neighbors watching at home, thank you. And blessings as we worship together on this most sacred day. This is our second event together as the Colonial Ministerium, not just the Plymouth White Marsh Ministerium. Our friends from churches in Conshohocken have joined us, and so we have taken to calling ourselves the Colonial Area Ministerium. So we welcome today churches from Lafayette Hill, Plymouth Meeting, and also Conshohocken. We also welcome Reverend Emmanuel Wilkinson, newly called to St. Jude in the Nativity in Lafayette Hill. Finally, I want to thank our musicians who've shared their gifts and worship and adoration and praise for today's service. Let us join together now in our call to worship as we call out for God's salvation on this Good Friday. Save me, O God. Do not let those who hope in you be put to shame because of me. Answer me, O Lord, for your steadfast love is good. According to your abundant mercy, turn to me. Do not hide your face from your servant, for I am in distress. Make haste to answer me.
Will you join with me in prayer? Today, O Holy One, we recognize that you make common cause with our human suffering. As we read the scriptures and sing the hymns, we feel the feelings of the day Christ died. We remember that suffering is not rational. It has no answer. But we also remember that in the cross, you meet us in our sufferings. From this day forward, we know that there is nowhere we can go where you are not with us. Into your hands, we commend our spirits. Amen.
Our first scripture reading is from Psalm 22. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me, from the words of my groaning? Oh my God, I cry by day, but you do not answer, and by night, but find no rest. Yet you are holy, enthroned on the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. To you they cried and were saved. In you they trusted and were not put to shame. But I am a worm and not human, scorned by others and despised by the people. All who see me mock at me. They make mouths at me. They shake their heads. Commit your cause to the Lord. Let him deliver. Let him rescue the one in whom he delights. Yet it was you who took me from the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you I was cast from my birth, and since my mother bore me, you have been my God. Do not be far from me, for trouble is near and there is no one to help. Many bulls encircle me, strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me like a ravening and roaring lion. I am poured out like water, and all my bones are out of joint. My heart is like wax, it is melted within me breast. My mouth is dried up like a potsherd, and my tongue sticks to my jaws. You lay me in the dust of death. For dogs are all around me. A company of evildoers encircles me. My hands and feet have shriveled. I can count all my bones. They stare and gloat over me. They divide my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots. But you, O Lord, do not be far away. O my help, come quickly to my aid. Deliver my soul from the sword, my life from the power of the dog. Save me from the mouth of the lion. From the horns of the wild oxen you have rescued me. I will tell your name to my brothers and sisters. In the midst of the congregation, I will praise you. You who fear the Lord, praise him. All you offspring of Jacob, glorify him. Stand in awe of him, all you offspring of Israel. For the Lord did not despise or abhor the affliction of the afflicted. He did not hide his face from me, but heard when I cried to him. From you comes my praise in the great congregation. My vows I will pay before those who fear him. The poor shall eat and be satisfied. Those who seek him shall praise the Lord. May your hearts live forever. All the ends of the earth shall remember and turn to the Lord, and all the families of the nations shall worship before him. For dominion belongs to the Lord, and the Lord rules over the nations. To him indeed shall all who sleep in the earth bow down. Before him shall bow down all who go down to the dust. And I shall live for him. Posterity will serve him. Future generations will be told about the Lord and proclaim his deliverance to a people yet unborn, saying, he has done it. Thanks be to God for this reading of God's holy word. Amen.
A reading from the Gospel of Luke. When they had come to that place they called the Skull, they crucified Jesus there with the criminals, one on his right and one on his left. Then Jesus said, "Father, forgive them, for they do not know what they are doing." And they cast lots to divide his clothing. Here ends the lesson. They do not know what they are doing? They do not know? They who killed Jesus? Who is they? It is so easy to name others, to blame others. The Romans, the crowd, Pilate, Herod, Caiaphas, they all played their part and conspired against Jesus, or simply followed orders to maintain the peace, to keep Jesus' kingdom from infringing on theirs. And yet, where are we when Jesus' kingdom infringes on ours, on our peace and our order, on our prosperity and our security? Where are we when the victims of our peace cry for justice, when those disenfranchised by our order call for compassion, when the hungry and the lonely beg us to share our prosperity, our security, and our power? Where are we when Christ is crucified among us? Surely he should have raged at the sinners who nailed him to the tree. Surely he should have raged at us for the evil we do, the evil we do both knowing and unknowing. Yet, compassion is there in the first words he utters. He intercedes for us before the Father. Compassion that called him into being in his mother's womb. Compassion that compelled him to the cross. Compassion that brings incredible, unbelievable grace. Compassion that echoes throughout the centuries to all who participate in the killing of Christ. Compassion that cries out from the cross, "Father, forgive them, for they know not what they are doing."
Spoke when all his word was. Bless these words, O God. Amen. Luke 23:39-43. One of the criminals who hung there hurled insults at him. Aren't you the Messiah? Save yourself and us. But the other criminal rebuked him. Don't you fear God? He said, since you are under the same sentence, we are punished justly, for we are getting what our deeds deserve. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said, Jesus, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus answered him, truly I tell you, today you shall be with me in paradise. The word of salvation. Hear, my beloved, you have Jesus Christ, the Son of the living God, who knew no sin but became sin, that you and I might have the right to eternal life. Hanging right smack in the middle of two thieves who were being crucified for what they had done. They deserved to be there. But Jesus, why? It was not an accident or unexpected. Nothing was left to chance. What God had decreed came to pass exactly as God had ordained. What Pilate didn't know was that he was putting into the execution the eternal decree of God and fulfilling his prophetic word, Isaiah 53:12, the Holy One hanging with the unholy. Jesus hanging between two thieves shows the depth of shame that he had gone to. At his birth, born in a stable surrounded by animals. At his death, numbered with the transgressors. As substitute, he took the place of criminals. He was despised. He was rejected. There Jesus is, right smack in the middle. So we may see the true picture of salvation in action and man's response. Both had access. Both heard the same word from those painful hours. Both dying. Both very truly suffering. Both needing forgiveness, and yet both looked at the Savior's redemption differently. A little like today, I would say. We can be in the same church, my beloved, hear the same word given by the same person, and yet there will be some who will hear the word and not hear it, who will be closed, who will not accept the word. And there will be others who will be open and realize that they need a Savior, and they will be open to receive what God has for them. My beloved, there is one who remains the same. He dies the same way he lived, hard, wicked, unapologetic, and unashamed, and dies in his sins. My beloved, he's headed straight to hell. While on the other hand, there is the one who is open. He sees his needs and desires to be drawn closer to God's offering of mercy. He seeks Jesus' mercy and forgiveness, and he repents. The gospel of Jesus Christ revealed to him, and pray God he is forgiven. And Jesus says, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. He didn't say tomorrow. He didn't say maybe. He didn't say I'll think about it. My brothers and sisters, he said, today thou shalt be with me in paradise. This, my beloved, reminds me of a deathbed conversion. The great and gracious good news of the Christian message is that any true conversion, no matter how late it comes, leads to eternal salvation. In fact, this is the essence of the gospel of God's free grace for sinners in Jesus Christ. We are saved, my beloved, not by anything we have ever done or anything we could ever do, but only by what Jesus has done for us. Someone who is converted on their deathbed has no time and no strength to do good works. He will probably not become a church member. He will probably not be baptized, not take the Lord's Supper, not attend a single worship service or a Bible study or a prayer meeting. He will probably not even give a single penny to the work of the church. And yet, the absence of all these things and many other good works besides will not jeopardize his salvation in any way. Why not? Because we are saved, my beloved, by grace through faith. It is the gift of God, not a result of our works, so that no one may boast in themselves. The conversion, my beloved, of this man hanging on the cross in the last hours of his life is a true highlight of what really happens in salvation. Everything else is stripped. Even though he might have been a terrorist, a thief, a robber, or committed capital crimes, he has hurt people and caused people pain. He is a guilty criminal who is getting what he deserves. He has nothing materially to offer God, nothing remotely resembling a good work, not a shred of righteousness or holiness within him. There is no hope that what he has done truly outweighs what he could have done. And yet, my beloved, he receives from the lips of Jesus Christ the strongest assurance anyone is ever given in all scriptures. Today, you shall be with me in paradise. He is completely and freely forgiven. In fact, my beloved, Jesus gives him extra assurance with the words, "Truly, I say to you, today thou shalt be with me in paradise." My beloved, Jesus was right smack in the middle of two thieves. One received salvation. The other died in his sins. Today, thou shalt be with me in paradise. Amen. Amen. Amen.
Thank you. third word from John 19, verses 25 to 27. And that is what the soldiers did. Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." Then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. For many years, I worked as a bereavement counselor and journeyed with people through real tragedies, and unfortunately, with those who lost a child. It is one of the greatest tragedies of life, and one that goes against all we hold as true. These words of Jesus to his mother at the cross bring to light the humanity and the horror of what is happening. It is a startling reminder that Jesus was human, that he was somebody's son, that he had been a child. Even as he was completing the greatest gift of love for the world, he remembers his mother. He does not, in his own tragedy and that of the world, forget those closest to him. And this poignant picture of Jesus does not tell the whole story. As we know from the scripture, Jesus was loved and had disciples that followed him and promised to carry on his message and ministry. However, here, in his darkest hour, in his greatest need, they are not there. In Jesus' greatest time of need, in his final hours, most of his disciples have fled with fear. Jesus is alone, except for those who were closest to him. The disciple whom he loved, which most scholars assume is John, and his mother. It's hard to think about being forgotten by all those we love, especially in our time of greatest need. And it's hard to think even about what Mary was experiencing. The loss, the pain, the grief. And I wonder if those words of many years earlier spoken by Simeon came to her heart and mind, and a sword will pierce your very soul. Suffering is something that none of us want in life. The suffering here of Jesus is powerful and poignant in its physical pain, in its reality of what Jesus gave up. However, here we also see the personal suffering and feel with Jesus the pain and grief. This scene helps us not to glorify or spiritualize the crucifixion. It brings a deeper level of reality and horror to what is happening. Jesus was a real person, true flesh and blood, a son of a mother, dying with unbearable agony. His suffering was altogether real, and he took it on for you and for me. It speaks in these times that we live into our own personal griefs and pain and losses. In these days of COVID-19, it is hard when so many of us have been affected by loss personally, not to feel this even more powerfully. It's also poignant that as we enter this season, it is for many of us, including my own family, the anniversary of losing a loved one to COVID. A loved one that we could not see or visit or be near as they were dying. And Mary's pain is too real and her grief almost overwhelming. The good news is that in the midst of that pain and grief and loss, Jesus is with us, caring for us, as he cared for Mary. He could not forget his mother, and he cannot forget us. Amen.
the fourth word, the Gospel of Mark, the 15th chapter, verses 33 and 34. When it was noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" These words always hit hard for me. You see, I don't know about you, but at least for me, there's this picture of Jesus, this picture of Jesus that I've had since I was a little kid. That picture of the humble Jesus, but the strong Jesus, the sure of faith Jesus, the confident Jesus, the Son of God Jesus. And yet here in these short verses, we see a broken Jesus, a suffering Jesus, a Jesus who cries out in uncertainty, a Jesus who cries out in almost doubt, asking God, "Why did you let this happen? Why aren't you here? My God, why have you forsaken me?" It doesn't fit with my normal picture of Jesus, but those words certainly resonate with the last year. My God, why have you forsaken me? They are probably words that all of us have either screamed at the top of our lungs or in the depths of our hearts. We've spent a year locked away, hiding away, protecting ourselves, our communities, our neighbors as best we can. We have spent the last year in isolation as people lose their jobs, as people suffer, as people are hungry. We sit and we watch as there's violence and anger and resentment all over the place. And I cannot help but yell out, my God, why have you forsaken me? Why have you forsaken us? We've suffered. We've hurt. It's been a long, painful year. A year that has pushed many of us to the breaking point, to the point of despair, to the point of hopelessness. And that's why these words, my God, why have you forsaken me, coming from the very mouth of Christ Jesus, our Lord, are so critically important to us. You see, because in these words, we see, we hear, we know that our Lord and Savior knows the pain that we know, knows the hardship that we know, knows the distress, the fear, the uncertainty that we know. In these words, in the cross of Christ, we see our God, not all powerful, but rather with us, knowing us, living the hardship, the fear, the pain that we know, that we experience, that we feel in our lives. We see a Savior who knows our journey. And here is the good news. Even though Jesus cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me, as so many of us have, God does not abandon Jesus. Jesus is not alone. Jesus' status as the Son of God is not revoked. But rather, God remains. The grace, the love, the forgiveness, the help of God remains. And so too does it with us. This year has been so hard. Many of us have cried out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And that's okay. Because the good news is that our Lord and Savior knows our journey, knows our struggle, knows our hardship, knows our fear, and knows our pain. And just as Jesus was not abandoned on the cross, nor are we. Amen.
Good day, friends. The fifth word. Afterwards, Jesus, knowing that all things were now accomplished, that scripture might be fulfilled, he said, I thirst. Allowing oneself to enter the passion story breaks us free of the theological distancing that Bible study can sometimes produce. The passion story is a gut-wrenching story that resonates with the pain and the suffering of our lives. This intimacy with the life of Jesus can drift away as we put the passion story back on the shelf and go on about our day. Is it possible to live at the foot of the cross continually? If so, how? This is a hard and searching question that all committed Christians must consider. As a boy whose life had already tasted violence, the passion story for me was pictures of Jesus bleeding and dying on the cross, a story of angry men and friends that fail you. Stories always found their way deep inside me. I had a hard time separating them from the events of my life. Even episodes of Lassie that showed a farm animal dying sent me out of the room. Each Easter, I squirmed on the benches of St. Peter's as the Gospels were read. Odd as it may seem, it is the smell of vinegar that brings back the intensity of this time of my life. As a boy, I could not fathom why anyone would give someone vinegar to drink. Vinegar was associated with the acid smell that emanated from my mother's iron. She finished each ironing session with the cleaning of the iron by filling it with vinegar and steaming it out the holes in its bottom until every drop was gone. The kitchen filled with an eye-tearing mist. Why would you give this liquid to someone to drink? With time, I've brought those experiences of my youth into what has become more and more common experience of a person my age, the accompanying of a beloved or a friend in the last venue of life. These opportunities have been blessed spiritual experiences that I would never trade, but also invoke the same gut-wrenching emotions that I first experienced as a child listening to the Passion story. Thirst is one of the sufferings of dying, a suffering that is responded to by the gentle moistening of lips and holding of a cup to enable a sip. Actions that bond two souls at the veil between life and death. Jesus upon the cross thirsted. His lips were the same that you and I have moistened during those blessed moments of being there for our beloveds. Jesus is suffering so fully a part of the human experience. His human plight distilled to the essence of human need. I thirst. Offering a vinegar drink, the last effort to relieve his suffering by those witnessing. Jesus, ever the teacher, even in this last hour, has set before us one more opportunity, or perhaps a better word, one more challenge to hear what he has been teaching. In his conversations with Nicodemus, and perhaps more successfully with the Samaritan woman at the well, he tried to move their understanding from the constraints of logic, the mind, or simply bodily need, thirst, to a continual experience of God's guiding presence via the living water and the baptizing spirit of the Holy Comforter. We read in John 14:26, "But the Comforter, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you all things and remind you of everything I have said to you." Nicodemus is restrained from understanding what Jesus is offering by his reliance on mental deduction, honed by years of study. To be reborn of spirit is a concept as foreign to him as re-entering a mother's womb to be reborn. He thirsts for explanations, logical solutions. He is more comfortable with trying to align Jesus' words with the written law than allowing Jesus to point him to the Holy Spirit welling up inside him. Yet even at Jesus' death, he is drawn to Jesus, knowing that there is more to understand and to learn. The Samaritan woman at the well grasps what Jesus is setting before her. She lets go of the restraints of the mind that led her to earlier say, "Sir, you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water?" She is listening from her heart as Jesus responds, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again, but whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become in them a spring of water welling up to eternal life." And she responds, "Sir, give me the water so that I won't get thirsty and have to come here to draw water." From the woman's action of calling her village neighbors to meet the Messiah, as she names him, we know she has grasped what Jesus was offering. She understands that if one is attentive to the Comforter, the thirst is quenched and the attentive one is drawn into eternal relationship with God. a relationship that provides guidance in everyday affairs and decisions. Jesus teaches us to experience life fully, the good and the bad. His proclamation, "I thirst," is a universal experience of both the bodily thirst and of our spiritual thirst to know and be in obedience to God's will. Here at the threshold of death, he affirms the need of the living water that he has nourished him all his life through temptation, giving authority to his teaching, obedience to God's will in his passion, and anointing him Messiah. In the mystery of the Trinity, God became man for us and thirsted. Are we thirsty? What do we thirst for? Will we drink from the cup of the living water? In the moments of life when our cross is before us, when we truly thirst for the presence of God, the words of John become alive in our hearts. The Comforter, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, will teach you things and remind you of everything I have said to you. May we each drink from the spring of living water, welling up to eternal life. Blessings to you all.
John 19, verses 29 through 30. A jar full of sour wine was standing there. So they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit. Author Virginia Stem Owens says this about Good Friday. Good Friday is the day when you can do nothing. Bewailing and lamenting your manifold sins does not in itself make up for them. Scouring your soul in a frenzy of spring cleaning only sterilizes it. It does not give it life. On Good Friday, finally, we are all, mourners and mockers alike, reduced to the same impotence. Someone else is doing the terrible work that gives life to the world. It is finished. As Jesus gives up his spirit on the cross, he offers us yet another gift, a simple statement, a mere three words that can mean so much in our own spiritual journeys. It is finished. A reminder that God's work in Jesus Christ, revealing God's kingdom of mercy and grace, of love and peace that is not coercive or domineering, but self-sacrificial, is complete. Complete even before we were baptized, complete even before we were born. The truth of God's salvation is work that has already been accomplished, and there is nothing we have to do to make it happen again, nor to earn it in our lives. It is finished. The words of an exhausted, innocent victim of this horrible way human beings treat one another. Hanging people on a cross to die in pain and to die in shame. The suffering, the humiliation, now over. At some point, life comes to an end. At some point, all things come to an end. Situations in our lives, relationships, heartache, pain, these all come to an end. Finished. No longer. Time for something else, something different. It is finished. The heartache and suffering, the depth of human failings and human feelings, felt and experienced by our Savior and Messiah, have run their course. When Jesus gives up his spirit, it is an acceptance that this current struggle is over, and whatever comes next is time to be now. How many times do we too, similarly, give in? Not quit, as it may sometimes seem, but relent and accept what must be. Not in this ultimate way, and I don't mean to minimize Jesus' suffering, the oppressive regime that was so abusive and violent to him. But one of the gifts of our faith is that we read these stories and we see ourselves in them, living out tiny versions of similar fates. We hold on to that one hope, that one last bit of life, that attempt at success or that one relationship, only to finally bow our heads and accept what must be. It looks like defeat, losing hope, part of us dying. But we know this is the only way to new life. This ultimate end of life, of relationships, of hopes, of dreams, is the only way to find something new, a new beginning that is yet unknown. The only way we can tolerate such death and loss is with faith. Faith that God is not done with us yet, still mapping out a way forward that is full of life, different, but full of life nonetheless. Looking into an unknown future is scary when we can't imagine a way forward that is meaningful. And yet, this is what we are called to do as Christians. To trust in God's future when it seems like darkness is overcoming us. It is finished, is the only way to get there. Amen.
Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love to sing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you came to save us. You came from heaven's work to show way from the earth to the world. My dead day, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I love seeing your praises. I'm so glad you're in my life. I'm so glad you're in the same. You came from heaven's work to show the way from the earth to the world. My death is great, from the cross to the grave, from the grave to the sky. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Lord, I lift your name on high. Hosanna, blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, glorify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. Hosanna, blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock, blessed be the rock of my salvation.
Good afternoon, I'm Father Quinlan, pastor of Epiphany of Our Lord Parish in Plymouth Meeting, and with you today as a member of the Colonial Ministerium. My reflection is on the seventh word of the Lord Jesus as he hung on the cross before he died. From the Gospel according to St. Luke, we read, "It was about noon, and darkness came over the whole land until 3 p.m. because of an eclipse of the sun. Then the veil of the temple was torn down the middle. Jesus cried out in a loud voice, 'Father, into your hands I commend my spirit.' And when he had said this, he breathed his last." The number 7 is significant in almost every culture throughout world history. Some have suggested that it comes from the 4 phases of the moon, which come in periods of 7 days. The week, therefore, is the original number from which the significance is derived. The significance of the number 7 in the Bible means totality, fullness, completeness, wholeness, or perfection. Thus, the 7 last words of Jesus comprise the most perfect sermon ever preached by the most perfect preacher who ever lived, from the most perfect pulpit ever erected, the cross. Having finished the mission of salvation and redemption, for which the Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us, was sent, Jesus breathed his last, quoting from the 6th verse of Psalm 31, "Father, into your hands I commend my spirit." The deacon Stephen, will later quote these words of Jesus as he was being stoned to death by his enemies. We learn from the Acts of the Apostles. Each one of us Christians is entrusted with a mission to finish, that like Jesus, we have received from our Heavenly Father. Like Jesus, we also need to embrace the cross of redemptive suffering if we hope one day to wear the crown of glory. That's why Jesus invites us to deny ourselves, take up our cross, and follow him. Jesus needed help to carry his cross, not because he was unwilling, but because he was unable. So too, we need help to carry our cross. Let's ask Jesus to help us carry our cross, like Simon of Cyrene helped Jesus to carry his, not because we are unwilling, but because we are unable. While a crucified Messiah was a scandal to some and an absurdity to others, for us Christians, the cross is a sign of victory. That's why we refer to it as a mystery, namely, a truth that we accept in faith, although we do not fully understand. Faith transcends reason. If faith were only a matter of reason, every reasonable person would be a believer. We know that is not the case. Faith is a gift from God that we sinners don't deserve or merit and cannot earn. Why God gives the gift of faith to some and not to others is a mystery known only to God himself. What we do know about the gift of faith is that if we don't use it, we'll lose it. It takes faith for us to surrender our human will and submit to God's divine will. In the midst of defeat, we need faith in victory. When we experience rejection from others, we need faith in God's acceptance of our true selves. Jesus had faith that after facing degradation from his persecutors, he would experience exaltation by his Father. On this Good Friday, as we journey with Jesus to Calvary and reflect on his seven last words, we give praise and thanks to God the Father for raising his Son Jesus from the dead on that first Easter Sunday. As we continue our earthly journey, by the power and grace of the Holy Spirit, may we make the seventh word of Christ on the cross our own. Father, into your hands I commend my spirit. Thank you.
As we bring the service to a close, let us pray. Lord, we pray that we do not leave Jesus alone, but we pick up our own cross, that God's way may be exalted and lifted up in this world. Go forth in peace. Amen.